This is sulfuric acid, and this is what would happen when it drips onto a piece of paper. Welcome back to part 4 of the OTC Chemical Series. And today, we're distilling concentrated sulfuric acid. Concentrated sulfuric acid is an extremely useful reagent that can be found in some drain cleaners. However, the distillation may not be as straightforward as you might think. I've been fine-tuning this process on and off for 9 years, and want to share my struggles and solution I've found so far. If you think, oh, this is yet another distillation video, and click away. Hold up. The distillation of concentrated sulfuric acid is much more complicated than just simple distillation. There are 4 common problems associated with sulfuric acid distillation. However, there are combinations of factors which can't be addressed individually. But don't worry, I will give a detailed breakdown of every important bit I can think of about distilling concentrated sulfuric acid, including the why and the how. This video is for educational purposes only. This is one of the experiments that fall into the category of really don't try this at home. It should be performed only by professionals in a very well ventilated area or a fume hood. I hope you really understand the risk should you choose to replicate anything you see in this video. In some countries, particularly in North America, sulfuric acid is commonly available as an acidic drain opener, which contains mostly 90 to 93% sulfuric acid and some inhibitors. So it's one of the easiest OTC sources of sulfuric acid. While you can use it directly for some reactions, you might want to purify it if you need its pure form or higher concentration. Sulfuric acid is unfortunately available only in some countries as drain opener. Some people, especially guys in Europe, might find it rather difficult to obtain it. Not all drain cleaner or opener contains sulfuric acid. Some contain bases like sodium hydroxide. So it's very important to identify the right one before we start distilling it. It is rather tricky to identify which drain opener contains sulfuric acid, though there are few signs that would indicate it contains sulfuric acid. Firstly, they usually come in a 1-liter bottle in a shape like this. Trust me bro, I've tried a few brands and they all look the same. They will also come with a sealed plastic bag to prevent leakage. These 2 signs alone usually already mean it's a sulfuric acid based drain opener. But we are scientists, right? You can't just rely on a name or external appearance to assume it contains sulfuric acid. We need to verify it through its MSDS. The MSDS provided by the manufacturer are often quite shady. I've come across many of them that don't list the exact chemicals. But as you can see from the boiling point and the specific gravity, it has aligned it with sulfuric acid boiling point charts almost perfectly. And that's the solid evidence that it contains sulfuric acid. In case you are not aware, this experiment should be conducted with the best possible glassware. Don't even think about it if the glassware is an lab-grade silicate glass. I wouldn't trust any cheap or unknown brand of glassware for this distillation. You also need to inspect your glassware carefully under good lighting to check for any cracks, bubbles, or unevenness before the start of this distillation. The heat will stress the glassware and equipment to a very high degree. Any support glassware could be the point of failure and lead to a disaster. Without further ado, let me walk you through the distillation setup for this experiment. I will first show you the setup I will be using. Then I will explain every component in detail and show you the possible variations in different parts. In my setup, I'm using a heating mantle that is capable of heating up to 380 degrees Celsius. A 1-liter Freenick round bottom flask, some glass stoppers, a standard distillation adapter, standard distillation receiver, a 200mm rigger column, glass jacket with thermocouple, some PTFE tape, and some broken clay pot pieces as boiling chip. Freenick round bottom flask is especially handy for loading material in the distillation setup, as you only need to remove one of the stoppers. Remember to add the boiling chip before you start loading the drain opener to the flask. I also recommend using a Freenick flask for this experiment. If you are doing multiple batches just like me, one important point to note though, you should only load the flask about halfway. This is to prevent any liquid boils over the adapter. The reason to only load the flask halfway is that a thermal expansion of concentrated sulfuric acid is enormous. As you can see, the liquid level rises significantly when heated. So it's better to be safe and not load the flask excessively. Let me go over some of the components that are worth mentioning. The first one being the choice of condenser. If the drain opener boils at over 270 degrees Celsius, and 19% sulfuric exit boils at 337 degrees Celsius, a sufficiently long air condenser with passive cooling will suffice for this application. And I use a recruit column for it, which is perfect. You may need a different condenser if the starting exit is at 90%. You may even need to switch condenser in different stages of the distillation if the starting exit is of low concentration. But this is out of scope for this video. In case you didn't already know, you must avoid using plastic parts, including plastic clamps or cat clips in the setup. They can withstand heat from the distillation and will melt right away. Also note that the paint or coating on some of your clamps might melt too. I strategically clamped my apparatus in a position that is less heated, so the coating on my clamps is less likely to melt. As I mentioned at the start of this video, there are four common problems associated with the distillation of concentrated sulfuric acid. I will present you with the problems, then with the solution in the order of importance. The first problem you might encounter is that the distillate struggles to reach the distilling head. This is the major problem for this distillation, since you can't distill anything if you can't reach the boiling temperature of sulfuric acid. The components that requires attention for this problem primarily is the heat source. 98% sulfuric acid boils at 337 degrees Celsius, and in reality, it requires a temperature much higher than this to sustain constant boiling. So one of the logical choices that might come to your mind is using a flame to heat it. While it will work, as you can see from other videos, I'm strongly against using open flame as I'm an advocate for flameless experiments. While I can't avoid using flame entirely, I prefer to use it only when it's necessary. And the risk involving hot concentrated sulfuric acid will be essentially amplified to a whole new level if the flame is involved. Another solution is to use a hot plate, but only some hot plates that usually have ceramic surface that are capable of delivering the heat required. Even then, you still need to modify your setup to use an Erlenmeyer flask instead of the free neck round bottom flask, which isn't ideal. My preferred option is the heating mantle, but I must warn you that most heating mantles may struggle to reach the required temperature. Some are limited to 300 degrees Celsius, while some can reach 450, and mine can reach 380. Which is just enough to boil 98% sulfuric acid. There are side advantages of using a heating mantle, as it will provide an additional cushioning effect should a bumping occur, lowering the impact, and can also act as a safety net should a leakage occur, giving you more time to escape the scene. It is also mandatory to insulate the distillation setup with aluminium foil, since there is a constant heat loss to the surroundings. And the vapor will struggle to reach the distillation head. Without the help of insulation, the solution will also potentially build up more superheated points due to the steep temperature gradient, and a flash boil might occur as well, which is really bad. This brings us to problem number 2, violent bumping or unstable boiling. As I just mentioned, flash boil or bumping can occur even just because of a steep temperature gradient. It can also occur due to insufficient nucleation sites or cool liquid dripping back to the flask. The solution to this is the second component, the boiling chip. It is the part that bothers me the most and has the most impact on smoothening the boiling process. I must warn you, do not underestimate the potential danger of flash boiling. The flash boiling of concentrated sulfuric acid is literally ground shaking. It will damage your apparatus as well as your bench or fume hood if accidents should have happened. I've undergone thorough research on different boiling chips for this experiment. I would recommend using broken clay pot pieces as the boiling chip. It is far superior to anything I've used so far for this experiment. But I will also show some of the other boiling chips that I've tested and show you the difference. The first one is broken glass. Is suggested by some other YouTubers, but as you can see from their footage and my experience, it just worsens the situation and increases violent bumping. My theory is that the glass not only not provide a nucleation site for smooth boiling to occur, they are even creating uneven hotspots to induce the more superheating spots in the solution. So this is definitely a no-go. The second one is snowballing chip. Yes, you heard me. Snowballing chip actually works better than broken glass. But still, the boiling is a little bit rough, so it's only viable if you do not have any other options. I do not have enough experience to tell whether this is a good method or not, so I need to do more testing in a later time and will update my findings in the comments. The third one is the Teflon stir bar. I always hesitated to use it in this experiment, as the temperature exceeds the workable range for Teflon according to the specification. But NerdRage's video has reported great success using the stir bar. The stir bar has been the best boiling chip for many experiments due to its stability and performance. So if you have one and don't mind trying, then definitely use it. My stir bar didn't change visually after the distillation, but it has almost completely demagnetized, as you can see when compared to a normal stir bar on the left. So I would dedicate this stir bar to my future sulfuric acid distillation. The fourth one is a broken clay pot. It's one of the porous material which can withstand the heats of boiling sulfuric acid while providing the required nucleation site. It is my personal choice of boiling chip when it comes to boiling sulfuric acid. The major downside is that it will leave scratch marks on the glass surface on prolonged distillation. So you might want to dedicate a flask for sulfuric acid distillation just to minimize damage it can cause using broken clay pots as boiling chip. The last one is sand. It works similarly to broken clay pot, but to a lesser extent. And somehow it will also slowly scratch the glass and leave some marks, just like clay pot. So I would recommend using clay pots over sand. And here comes problem number 3, leakage during the distillation. It is rather common for leakage to occur in this experiment, especially when a setup reaches the boiling temperature of 98% sulfuric acid. It is, however, not a big deal compared to the first two problems, but it can still cause issue for you and your surroundings if not managed properly. The problem exists simply because joint sealants are very limited for this experiment. Sulfuric acid is highly corrosive and oxidizing at high temperatures, so getting a grease for that purpose isn't easy. Typically for this type of distillation, you can use concentrated sulfuric acid as a joint lubricant. But this is tricky since we're doing this experiment to get concentrated sulfuric acid. Even if you manage to find concentrated sulfuric acid as joint sealant, it may still boil in the joints and leak through somehow. It is also not guaranteed to separate the joint smoothly after the experiment. So apart from high quality heat resistant grease, NerdRage suggests a very affordable option of using PTFE tape from hardware stores as the joint sealant. They're cheap, easily accessible, and rather resistant to heat and corrosion in this experiment, which is ideal as the joint sealant. I tried it with and without PTFE tape as the joint sealant, and the result is very significant. Okay, so here is the last problem. Problem number 4, which is the timing of collecting the distillate. In a typical distillation setup, we use the thermometer to measure the vapor temperature to determine when to start collecting the distillate. But for concentrated sulfuric acid distillation, it's a bit tricky. Since it is boiling at 337 degrees Celsius, the instrument can be used for temperature measurement is rather limited. You can either use a mercury thermometer or a thermocouple for the temperature measurement. The tricky part for this component is usually getting the right glass jacket for the thermocouple. Also, I should note that a plastic thermometer holder can actually be used in this setup because the vapor fronts of sulfuric acid wouldn't reach the top end of the holder, so it will remain relatively cool and the plastic cap won't melt. For those who don't have access to the luxury of temperature measurement, don't worry, because it's not that important for this particular experiment. You can use a distillation adapter with the thermometer insert for this experiment. The procedure for the distillate collection part will be slightly different though, and I will explain later in this video. For those who can measure the distillate temperature, simply wait for a distillate to go up to 337 degrees Celsius or stabilize somewhere close to it. Because my thermocouple is actually measuring the glass jacket rather than the vapor directly, so you should expect the temperature measured to be slightly lower than 337 degrees Celsius. Also, just a side note, if you insulated your setup too well all the way to the distilling head, the glass jacket or thermometer holder might just get too hot, which melts plastic. One can still determine the relative concentration of the distillate without a temperature measurement. Simply drip a drop of distillate onto a piece of paper towel every so often and check for its reaction. The paper should begin to turn brown and dissolve relatively quickly once the acid had reached its maximum concentration. It will take much longer to dissolve if it's not 98%. Secondly, you can swap out the receiving flask every so often until you no longer see a change in refractive index. As the acid reaches its highest concentration, the density will stop changing. By combining these two facts, you can accurately determine the timing for collecting the distillate. Distilling a single batch of 500ml of drain opener usually takes 5 to 7 hours, and I usually run multiple batches in a single run to save time. To do so, simply let the setup cool down and refill the flask using a funnel and restart your heating again. Oh, by the way, for low viewers like you, I've crafted a poster-style cheat sheet for this experiment. Summarizing some tips from this video, you can download for free from the link in my Patreon. Now let's get back to the video and talk about the yield, which I didn't really measure it. Since I'm doing multiple batches back to back, the overall recovery rate is about 80% give or take. Also, if you spill any acid on your gloves during refilling or at any point during the experiment, remember to swab it out as sulfuric acid can slowly penetrate your gloves. Concentrated sulfuric acid is very well known for its dehydration property. To test the product you just collected, simply drop a few drops to a sugar cube. The sugar cube will soon start to turn brown, then black, releasing heat and water vapor, eventually dehydrated to a black piece of carbon. Of course, you can test it a little bit more scientifically by checking its density via weight measurement or by using a hydrometer for specific gravity from 1.8 to 1.9. I will attach links for specific gravity chart that I use. In my opinion, using a hydrometer is the superior choice due to its convenience and accuracy. Its density measurement with scale would sometimes be quite far off from the results due to low accuracy and precision of my equipment. From the hydrometer reading alongside with the dehydration property I just demonstrated, I can confidently conclude the sulfuric acid we obtained is indeed 98%. Oh, one last thing, room temperature concentrated sulfuric acid doesn't hurt your skin as much as you would think, provided that you rinse it off quickly enough. Let me show you.